Peter, this is one of what's called the general epistles, James, 1st and 2nd Peter, 1st, 2nd and 3rd John and Jude. They're called general epistles because for the most part their intended audience is Christians in general rather than specific churches or specific congregations. So for example, in Paul's letters, he writes to the church at Corinth, the churches of Galatia, the saints in Ephesus, to Timothy, to Titus, to very specific groups of either individuals or congregations. The general epistles are written to groups of Christians rather than to specific individuals or congregations. And so in this first letter, 1 Peter, he covers a wide field of Christian theology and ethics. He speaks about the great doctrine of salvation from its beginning before the foundation of the world in God's foreknowledge to regeneration and the new birth, and finally to its culmination in the great inheritance that we have that is imperishable, undefiled, and kept in heaven for you. And so he repeatedly in this letter calls believers to holiness and to a simple trust in God for our daily needs. He gives practical counsel for a number of things, for marriage, for work, for submitting to the government, for witnessing to unbelievers, for using spiritual gifts, and even for serving as an elder. Now, 1 Peter also addresses the subject of suffering in the life of a Christian, right? And if you're familiar with the letter, you realize that that is really the predominant theme of 1 Peter. And so if I counted correctly, the word suffer or trial or some variation of those words is found a total of 19 times, and there are only 105 verses in this letter. So that's about one out of every five verses addresses in some way this idea of suffering or trials. And some of those references are to the sufferings of Christ, but most of them are to the sufferings that Christians we experience. So that's a major theme of this letter. So let me ask some questions, and we'll answer some questions, just given kind of by way of general review, overview. Where was Peter when he wrote this letter, 1 Peter? Does anybody know? Well, he says in 1 Peter 5:13 that he was in Babylon. He says, "She who is at Babylon, who is likewise chosen, sends you greetings, and so does Mark, my son." So that's almost certainly not a reference to the ancient city of Babylon, because by the time he's writing, Babylon was in ruins, and there's no evidence that there were any Christians in the actual city of Babylon. So it's likely that's a reference to Rome, and there are several references in the book of Revelation to Rome as being called Babylon. So, and there's some other evidence that seems to confirm that Peter was most likely in Rome when he wrote this letter. So when did he write it? Well, it's impossible to know exactly, but most commentators believe it was in the early 60s AD, probably about 62 to 64 AD. Okay, to whom was it written, and what were his hearers experiencing? Well, if you look in verse 1 of chapter 1, 1 Peter, it says to the elect exiles of the dispersion in Pontus, Galatia, Cappadocia, Asia, and Bithynia. And these are all areas, regions of northern Asia Minor in what is now modern-day Turkey. And if you look on a map, kind of the order in which these regions are listed, if you look at a map, it roughly forms a circle, okay? And so that would have been probably the route that the carrier of this letter took as he brought this letter to these different groups of Christians in these different regions, a very large area of modern-day Turkey. What do we know about the hearers, his original hearers of this letter? Well, as I mentioned earlier, they were enduring much suffering and persecution for their faith. And we see examples of suffering mentioned in each of the five chapters of this letter. And so I'm not going to take the time to look at all those, but if you read through 1 Peter, you can see that for yourselves. So another question to ask is, who were the recipients? Were they primarily Jewish or Gentile converts? And you might think initially, if you're just looking at the book, that they were primarily Jewish, because one reason is in that verse 1, he calls them the elect exiles of the dispersion. And that term dispersion generally refers to the dispersing of Jewish converts from Jerusalem due to the persecution that arose. And you can read about that specifically in Acts 8, 1 and 2. And also Peter mentions, he assumes that his hearers know the Old Testament because he quotes from the Old Testament in each of these chapters. And he also mentions several Old Testament characters. He mentions Abraham, the prophets, Sarah, and Noah. Okay? However, there are other reasons to indicate that primarily these believers that he's writing to were Gentile converts. Okay? And so how do we know this? Well, let me give you, we'll look at a couple of verses that kind of give us some clues. So chapter 1, verse 14, just scan down to verse 14 of chapter 1. He says, "As obedient children, do not be conformed to the passions of your former ignorance." And this idea, that phrase, "the passions of your former ignorance," suggests a pagan past that would be more characteristic of Gentile converts. Okay? And then just down a couple of verses in verse 18 of chapter 1, just skim down a couple of verses, verse 18, he says, "Knowing that you were ransomed from the futile ways inherited from your forefathers." And that phrase, "futile ways inherited from your forefathers," would also seem to be more descriptive of Gentiles than Jews. You remember, the Jews had been given the oracles of God. Paul writes that in Romans 3, 1 and 2. You can just listen to this. "Then what advantage has the Jew, or what is the value of circumcision? Much in every way." To begin with, the Jews were entrusted with the oracles of God. Right? So this idea of being, you know, having being ransomed from futile ways inherited from your forefathers would be more appropriate if they were actually, they were Gentile converts. Okay, another verse, just drop down to chapter 2. Chapter 2, verse 10. Look over there. So we're going to be doing a lot of kind of skimming through this first three chapters. Chapter 2, verse 10, we read, "Once you were not a people, but now you are God's people. Once you had not received mercy, but now you have received mercy." So again, that idea of once you were not God's people, now you are God's people, is more applicable to Gentile converts than to Jewish ones. And then one last verse, look over chapter 4. Chapter 4, verse 3, we read, "For the time that is past suffices for doing what the Gentiles want to do, living in sensuality, passions, drunkenness, orgies, drinking parties, and lawless idolatry." Okay, and these are all kind of sins that would be more characteristic of Gentiles than Jews, because remember, the Jews followed a very strict moral code. And so they would be more likely to be guilty of a kind of a Pharisaical self-righteousness than some of these sins that he identifies here. But how about, go back to chapter 1, but what about this reference in chapter 1 where he says they're the elect exiles of the dispersion? Well, probably that's, you know, literally a reference to Jews, but I think Peter is applying it as a metaphor to Gentile believers. He's saying that the believers he is writing to, they are the new people of God, but they are exiles or strangers in this world whose true home is not on earth but in heaven. Okay, so I think that's how we can explain that verse, reference to the dispersion. So, although Peter is primarily writing to Gentile believers, there were also certainly some converted Jews in his audience, because at the day of Pentecost, according to Acts chapter 2, verse 9, there were present in Jerusalem residents of Cappadocia, Pontus, and Asia. That's what we're told in Acts 2:9, and those are three of the regions that Peter is writing to. So they're very likely Gentile converts in these churches, these groups of believers that he's writing to as well. All right. So what's the purpose of the letter? Okay. Well, as I've said already, the main purpose, the main theme is suffering as a Christian. So the purpose of the letter is to encourage believers to stand fast, to grow in their trust and obedience to God in all aspects of their lives, but especially when they suffer, okay? And so Peter does this. First, he begins there in chapter 1, first by praising God for the great salvation that God has accomplished for his hearers in Christ. And he does that in chapter 1, verses 3 through 12. And then he applies those truths, these great truths of our salvation, he applies those truths to his readers' lives to give them hope in the midst of their suffering. And there's one verse probably that best summarizes all of these issues than any other verses in this letter, and that's 1 Peter 4:19. So turn over there. 1 Peter 4:19. First 1 Peter 4:19, so he says, Peter writes, therefore, let those who suffer according to God's will entrust their souls to a faithful Creator while doing good. And so we see the ideas of suffering, right? Those who suffer, we see the idea of trusting God, because their suffering, he says, is according to God's will, which should result in a continual entrusting of their souls or their lives to God as a faithful Creator. And this trust should be accompanied by obedience, because they should continue to do good or do right, even in the midst of their suffering. All right, so that's kind of a key verse for the letter. Okay, so let's talk a little bit about Peter. Who was Peter? Well, he identifies himself here in verse 1, chapter 1, back in chapter 1. He says, Peter, an apostle of Jesus Christ. Now, most of us know who Peter was, but just by way of review, you remember Peter was the name given to Andrew's brother Simon by Jesus very early in his ministry. You remember how Andrew brings his brother Simon to Jesus in John 1:42, we're told this. Andrew, brought him to Jesus, Peter. Jesus looked at him and said, you are Simon, the son of John. You shall be called Cephas, which means Peter. And Cephas is from the Aramaic word, and Peter is from the Greek word for rock. So Peter designates himself as an apostle. Now, what is an apostle? Does anybody know? Sent one, messenger. Yeah, that's literally what it means. The word means messenger, or sent one. And in the ancient world, this title, apostle, was even used for like government officials who were commissioned to speak in the name of Caesar or some other official. Okay. But Peter is obviously more than just a mere messenger, right? He's an apostle directly appointed and commissioned for that office by Jesus himself. And so Mark tells us, just listen to this, Mark tells us in Mark 3:13-16, he says, and he, Jesus, went up in the mountain and called to him those whom he desired, and they came to him. And he appointed 12, whom he also named apostles, so that they might be with him, and he might send them out to preach and have authority to cast out demons. He appointed the 12, Simon, to whom he gave the name Peter. All right? So those who held this office of apostle, they had great authority. They had authority at least equal to the Old Testament prophets, because the apostles could speak and write God's very words. Okay, and so we're told this in a couple places in the New Testament. For example, you can just listen to these verses. We won't take the time to turn to them. But 1 Corinthians 14:37, this is Paul writing. Paul says, if anyone thinks that he is a prophet or spiritual, he should acknowledge that the things I am writing to you are a command of the Lord. Okay, so the words that the apostles spoke were direct, had the authority of God's word itself. And so when Peter identifies himself as an apostle, he is writing to as someone who has been directly commissioned by Christ to proclaim God's, to write God's authoritative word to his churches, and that word which became part of the New Testament scripture. Okay, so what else do we know about the life of Peter? So as an apostle, he had remarkable gifts and graces, but what else do we know about Peter, right? He had some notable failings. And if you're familiar with his life at all, you remember that he possessed great zeal, courage, and boldness. He preached the gospel boldly on the day of Pentecost, and then he's arrested by the Sanhedrin, you remember? And then he continues to preach about Christ to the Jewish leaders, the high priest, and his family. And we're told in Acts 4:13, this familiar passage, now when they saw the boldness of Peter and John and perceived that they were uneducated, common men, they were astonished, and they recognized that they had been with Jesus. And so Peter was part of, what else do we know about Peter? Well, he was part of the inner core of Jesus' disciples, right? Along with James and John. He was with Christ when he was transfigured on the mountain in Matthew 17. He was also with James and John in the Garden of Gethsemane when Jesus took them with him to pray for him before his arrest. Peter's the one who gets out of the boat on the Sea of Galilee and walks to Jesus upon Christ's command. So he had privileges that were not given to all of the other apostles. What else did he do? Well, he healed multitudes of people. Acts 5:12 says he regularly performed signs and wonders among the people. And then how did Peter, at least according to tradition or church history, how did he die? Upside down. He was crucified upside down because he didn't feel that he was worthy to be crucified in the same manner that Christ was. Right. Okay, so yeah, despite all these great character strengths and privileges, he also had a number of failures. You remember some of these? What did he do? Well, he impulsively cut off the high priest's servant's ear in the garden before Jesus' arrest, and Jesus rebukes him for doing that in John 18. Jesus also rebukes him strongly when he tries to tell Christ that Jesus will not go to Jerusalem and be killed in Matthew 16, 22 and 23. Do you remember that exchange? And so, but he, Jesus, turned and said to Peter, "Get behind me, Satan. You are a hindrance to me, for you are not setting your mind on the things of God, but on the things of man." And then you remember, you know, Peter's most, you know, grievous fall in denying Jesus three times on the night that he was betrayed. Despite his assurance to Christ immediately beforehand, he assures Jesus that even if I must die with you, I will not deny you. Okay, and then he denies him three times. So he was a man of great strengths, great gifts, great graces, but also a man of great failures. And so it's interesting to note that Peter identifies himself simply as an apostle of Jesus Christ. He doesn't call himself the chief apostle or the prince of the apostles, or even the apostle to the circumcised. That's what Paul calls him in Galatians 2:8. And so you may know this, but the Catholic Church venerates Peter, views Peter as the prince of the apostles. That's what they call him. And so they venerate him above the other apostles. And there's even there's a Saint Peter, Prince of the Apostles Catholic Church and School right here in San Antonio and probably other cities as well. But Peter, he doesn't ascribe any such preeminence to himself, right? He simply says, he calls himself an apostle, all right? Because he was aware, he knew that he had been restored after his grievous fall through repentance, that Christ had restored him after Jesus' death and resurrection in order to feed Christ's sheep and to fulfill his calling as an apostle. And so there's a commentary I mentioned a couple years ago. I don't know if anybody remembers, but it's by a man by the name of William Layton. He was a Scottish Presbyterian pastor, and he was the Archbishop of Glasgow back in the 17th century. And so there was a commentary he wrote on the book of 1 Peter. It wasn't published until after he died in 1684, but it's really interesting. It's a very kind of a readable devotional commentary. It's not real technical, but if you have any interest in 1 Peter, it's well worth reading. So this is what he says about Peter just making this statement of simply calling himself an apostle. He says, "Thus we have in our apostle a special instance of human frailty on the one hand and the sweetness of divine grace on the other. Free and rich grace it is indeed that forgives and swallows up multitudes of sins, even the greatest sins, not only sins before conversion, as in the case of St. Paul, but foul offenses committed after conversion, as in the case of David and in the case of this apostle. By God's grace, Peter becomes God's messenger." And so that should be a very great encouragement to us as well. God can not only forgive and restore great offenses, but he can make people very useful in his kingdom, right? So most of us, I don't think, are, you know, we don't have this issue that the Catholic Church has of over-esteeming the Apostle Peter. I don't think, any, you know, unless you're from a Catholic background and that's something you're still, you know, struggling with, right? But we can be guilty, I think, maybe of a similar error. We can hold men from church history, or even maybe contemporary preachers, in such high regard that we overlook their faults or even come to the point of almost idolizing them, right? And this is not healthy, and it can be a sign of spiritual immaturity. So I'm thankful that, you know, we have men. God has given us men like, you know, Spurgeon and Lloyd-Jones and Paul Washer and John Piper and John MacArthur and Steve Lawson and R.C. Sproul and these, you know, these wonderful, godly, gifted teachers and preachers. And we should thank God that he has gifted the church with certain men who have this, you know, extraordinary preaching and teaching gifts. And so, and there's, we have biblical warrant to imitate them, right? Or to follow them. What does Hebrews 13:7 tell us? Hebrews 13:7, I'll read it, says, Remember your leaders, those who spoke to the word of who spoke to you the word of God. Consider the outcome of their way of life and imitate their faith. All right? And then in 1 Corinthians 11, 1, Paul says, be imitators of me as I am of Christ. Okay? So but the standard of our imitation of others is always to be as that person is imitating Christ, right? And so we have an example of this kind of this problem, of over-esteeming certain men, even in the early church, right? Where do we see that? 1 Corinthians. Yeah, 1 Corinthians, right? A lot of problems there in Corinth, okay? Many problems. But the first problem that Paul addresses there is this the divisions that were occurring among them, right? And the divisions were occurring because some of them were identifying themselves as followers of Paul. Others were followers of Apollos. Others were followers of Cephas, of Peter, instead of all of them being simply followers of Christ. And then in chapter 3 of 1 Corinthians, Paul says that he can't even address them as spiritual. He has to address them as fleshly or carnal because of this jealousy and strife that existed due to their immaturity in identifying themselves with one apostle over another. And so, I just think that should be a warning, right, even to us here at Grace Community Church in 2020, right? We want to guard against tendencies to follow any one man or esteem anyone more highly than we esteem the Lord Jesus Christ. So we want to imitate godly men and women as they imitate Christ, but always with our eyes fixed squarely on Jesus Christ himself. Okay, so that's just by kind of way of review. Background. So now we're going to make a kind of a very quick survey of these chapters. So chapter 1, Peter begins with a standard greeting in verses 1 and 2, very common. Most of the epistles have a greeting. The writer says who he is and who he's writing to. Usually it's one or two verses. But it's interesting, his greeting here, he gives quite a bit of theology in his greeting, and we won't have time to get into all of it, but he speaks of the salvation that his readers have obtained there in verses 1 and 2. He says, according to the foreknowledge of God the Father, in the sanctification of the Spirit, and for obedience to Jesus Christ and for sprinkling with his blood. All right? And so we see that all three members of the Trinity are identified as being involved in their salvation and involved in our salvation as well. All right. Then in verse 3, Peter begins to bless and to praise God for this great salvation that we've been given. And so he blesses God there in verse 3 for God's great mercy that has caused us to be born again to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, to an inheritance that is imperishable, undefiled, and unfading, kept in heaven for you. And we spent a lot of time looking at that, this living hope that we've been born again into. But it's interesting, in the Greek, this passage here from verse 3 down to verse 12 is just one long, complex sentence, okay? And so it's as if Peter, he just can't stop writing. As he begins to bless God and praise God for the salvation that we have, that these persecuted believers have, and he just has to keep going, kind of this doxology of praise. And it goes all the way down to verse 12, and he finally pauses. Okay, at least in the original. And so what he's doing here in this first section of these first 10 verses 3 through 12, he's declaring doctrinal truths about the great salvation that we have in Christ, and he's stating facts about the believers' lives to whom he's writing. And so it's not till you get down to verse 13 where we see the first imperative statement. What is an imperative statement? A commandment, right. So the first 12 verses, he's declaring doctrine, he's saying truths about his readers, and it's not till we get down to verse 13 that he says, therefore, right, in light of these truths, in light of this great salvation that we have, in light of the living hope we've been born again into through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, therefore, and then he gives a command, preparing your minds for action and being sober-minded, set your hope fully on the grace that will be brought to you at the revelation of Jesus Christ. So he spends 12 verses laying a foundation of doctrine and making statements about truth before he says anything about, what we should do or how we should respond or, how we should live, right? And so And this is very common. This pattern is common in the New Testament. You may be aware of this. Paul does the same thing in the book of Romans. You remember that? He spends about 11 chapters just developing all kinds of doctrine, justification and sanctification and regeneration, election, right? There's just a lot of theology, a lot of doctrine in the first 11 verses, primarily. And then he gets to verse 12, and then he says, therefore, offer your bodies as a living sacrifice, okay? So in light of all this doctrine, and then he spends the last three chapters of Romans really giving kind of ethical commandments and things, instructions and commands about how we should live. He does the same thing in the book of Ephesians. I don't know if you remember that. In the first three chapters, he spends a lot of time just expounding on doctrine and the doctrines of salvation. And then the last three chapters of Ephesians, he has a therefore there in Ephesians 4:1, and then he gives commands and instructions about how we should live and act. And so what do we learn from this? Well, we learn from this that it's important to lay a foundation of solid doctrine before addressing commands and instructions about how we should live and act. Okay, so that's the pattern that Peter follows also. Okay, what else do we see here in chapter 1? Well, in verses 6 and 7, Peter, he acknowledges the trials that his readers were experiencing. And of course, you remember that they were going through very intense persecution because of their faith. And, most of us probably are not going to experience the kind of persecution that these believers experience, probably, right? I mean, things are getting worse, but, probably not. But we're all going to go through trials and sufferings of various kinds, okay? And so, but what does he say in verse 6 about these trials? Well, he says, it's very interesting, he says, in this you rejoice, though now for a little while, if necessary, you have been grieved by various trials, if necessary. And so what does that teach us? Well, that teaches us that the sufferings we go through are necessary. In other words, they're not random acts of nature or fate, but they are the will of God for his children. And then he says in verse 7, he gives, what's the purpose for the trials that we're going to experience? Well, he tells us, he says, sufferings and trials test the genuineness of our faith, and they reveal whether our faith is authentic or not. Okay, so they're not random. And then in verse 8, he goes on to say that despite the severe trials his hearers were experiencing, he says, they rejoice with joy that is inexpressible and filled with glory. Okay, and that's a great phrase. And that word, you see that there in verse 8 towards the end, rejoice with joy that is inexpressible and filled with glory. And that word that is translated inexpressible, it's only found one time in the Bible, in the New Testament, right here. And it describes a joy that is so profound it is beyond the power of words to express. So it can be translated unutterable or unspeakable. And so, if these Christians who were suffering tremendous persecution, they had been scattered, if they could rejoice, and he's describing them here. This is a statement of fact. He says that you do this. You're rejoicing with a joy that is inexpressible. So if these Christians could rejoice in the midst of their suffering with this kind of a joy, well, I mean, we as 21st century American Christians ought to be able to rejoice with this kind of joy as well, right? And in fact, this is normal Christianity. So, what about you and me? Would you say your life is characterized by a joy that is so profound you can't even put it into words? An inner joy that's not affected by the external circumstances and difficulties you're experiencing? Well, that should be a reality in our lives, right? So another thing to notice here in chapter 1 is that Peter, in two places, he addresses the doctrine of regeneration. And verse 3, he declares that God in his great mercy has caused us to be born again to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. And then in verse 23, you can drop down to verse 23, he says, since you have been born again, not of perishable seed, but of imperishable through the living and abiding word of God. Okay? And so the emphasis in both of these places is on the fact that God is the one who is responsible for granting the new birth, okay? And so, this is something that happens to us, having been born again, all right? So God is the one who initiates and causes the new birth. And then in verse 23, though, he kind of amplifies and he says, that the instrument that God uses to bring about this new spiritual life is what? He says it's the seed, the imperishable seed of God's word. Okay, he says, since you have been born again, not of perishable seed, but of imperishable, how? Through the living and abiding word of God. And then he even kind of clarifies that because of verse 25, he says, and this word that he's talking about, he says, is the good news that was preached to you. So even specifically the gospel is what God uses to cause men and women to be born again. The Holy Spirit comes and takes the seed of his word. And so, you know, that's just a good reminder. I know we know that, most of us, but it's a good reminder that if we want to see people saved, right, like our children or our neighbors or friends or people you're evangelizing, we need to expose them as much as possible to God's word, right? And pray that the Holy Spirit will plant the seed of that word in their souls and produce in them the new birth. So we don't need gimmicks. We don't need entertainment. We don't need props. We don't need puppet shows, special music, etc. But we need the imperishable seed of the living and abiding word of God, right? Because that's what God is going to use. So may he do so even in our midst. Amen. All right. So there's a lot more in chapter 1 that we're going to have to pass over for the sake of time, but just wanted to highlight those things. So move on to chapter 2. Excuse me. Excuse me. Wrong pipe. Sorry. Okay, chapter 2. So, what do we see there? Well, in verse 1, Peter, he gives a command. He says, put away all malice and all deceit and hypocrisy and envy and all slander. So, he lists these sins that we are to put away, to put off. And these are sins that directly affect the health and the vitality of our fellowship or of the church. And these sins, in particular, can destroy the bonds of love, fervent love, that we are to have for one another. And if you go back up to chapter 1, just go back up a couple verses there to 22, one of the things that we are commanded, one of the commands we're given into 22 is to love one another earnestly from a pure heart. Okay? And so if we're going to obey that command, we've got to put away these sins that he identifies here, malice, deceit, envy, slander, hypocrisy. All right. Then he goes on to verse 2. He says, like newborn infants, long for the pure spiritual milk that by it you may grow up into salvation. Okay, and so he's giving a picture or an analogy. So, I mean, how much do infants crave milk? A little bit? A lot, right? I mean, we haven't had an infant in a while, but I mean, I think if an infant is not sleeping, it's basically, craving milk, okay? Why? Because babies need their mother's milk to survive physically and for their bodies to grow, right? And so in a similar fashion, he's saying that we as believers, we need to strongly crave and desire spiritual milk to survive and to grow spiritually. Okay, and what is that milk? Well, he says he describes it as pure and spiritual. And so the milk that he has in mind is again, simply the Word of God. All right? And so not only are we are people born again through the living and abiding Word of God, but we grow and we're nourished and we're sustained in our spiritual life by the Word of God, all right? And so he's saying that we need to have a craving, like a baby has a craving for its milk, for the Word of God, right? And this is a craving that we don't outgrow. We need, all of our lives, we need to be thirsting and craving the milk of God's Word in order that we may grow up into salvation, that we can mature in our salvation, all right? Then in verses 4 and 5, we're just kind of skim through here. He talks about believers. He identifies them or he likens them to living stones being built up as a spiritual house to be a holy priesthood to offer spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God through Jesus Christ. Okay, so now he identifies believers. He uses some metaphors, living stones being built up as a spiritual house to be a holy priesthood. Now, you remember in the Old Testament, the priesthood was limited, right? You had to be a member of the tribe of Levi, so only a portion of Israel could carry out the priestly duties. All right? But in the New Covenant, Peter's reminding us, telling us that all of God's people are his priests, right? And not just pastors and missionaries and others who are, set aside for special ministry. All believers, we have direct access to God through the death and resurrection of Christ, and we can offer up spiritual sacrifices, and we should, that are pleasing and acceptable to God. All right, and then verse 9, he kind of expounds on this. Just drop down to verse 9. He says, now he identifies believers as a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people for his own possession. And then he gives the purpose. You know, why have we been made a royal priesthood and a holy nation, a people for his own possession? Well, he tells us why. He gives us the mission or the purpose of the church there at the end of verse 9. He says, to proclaim the excellencies of him who called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. Okay, that's our mission. And so how do we do that? How do we proclaim God's excellencies? Well, we can do that in worship. When we're proclaiming his excellencies, we're proclaiming his praises to him and to one another, right? And we can do that in evangelism when we proclaim his greatness and his excellencies to non-believers, all right? So that's our business. That's what we should be about. Okay, then we'll drop down. Gotta pick up the pace. Verses 13 through 17, he gives some instructions to all believers to submit to every human institution. Verse 13, be subject for the Lord's sake to every human institution. And so this is a commandment to obey governing authorities, okay? Right? Now, it's not an absolute command because ultimately God is our authority, and so there may be times when, circumstances in which if we to obey the government might cause a Christian to sin or to violate God's will, right? And we've seen that recently with some governments, forbidding churches to meet during this pandemic. So there's a time when we have to disobey. But in general, he's giving a command, a general truth, that Christians should be inclined to obey and to submit to all forms of authority, whether you agree with their policies or not. All right, that's the general principle. Now, when he says every human institution, he says be subject for the Lord's sake to every human institution, whether they're the emperor or the governors. That makes this a little bit more broader than just the government. He says every human institution we are to be subject to. What other human institutions is there an authority, a hierarchy? Well, a lot, right? Parents and children. So children are to submit to their parents. Church leaders and members are to submit to our leaders. Employers and employees. There's an authority structure there. Teachers and students. Authority structure in even voluntary organizations. So God has established these patterns of authority for the orderly functioning of human society, and it pleases him and honors him when we subject ourselves to authorities who are over us. Okay, so that's what he's stressing in those verses. Now, drop down to chapter 3. He addresses, all of us are to be subject to governing authorities, to human institutions. And he talks about servants being subject to your masters, which would have an application to employers, employees being subject to their employers. Then down in chapter 3, verses 1 and 2, he's going to address wives. He says wives are to be subject to or submissive to their own husbands. And so what purpose? Why is that? Why should they? Well, he tells us, so that even if some do not obey the word, some of their husbands, they may be won without a word by the conduct of their wives when they see your respectful and pure conduct, okay? So he gives some instructions to wives and then a reasoning why wives should be submissive and subject to their own husbands, all right? And then verses 3 and 4 of chapter 3, he gives some instruction he focuses on a wife's true beauty, which he says consists not of external visible things that will perish, but rather in unseen spiritual realities which are eternal. Right? He says in verse 3, do not let your adorning be external. And adorning refers to the focus of attention for someone's attractiveness, the thing that a wife or woman would use to make herself beautiful to others. And so he's saying that Christian wives should focus their adorning not on outward things like, and he gives some examples, braiding of the hair, wearing jewelry, extravagant clothing, but rather on inner qualities, especially a gentle and quiet spirit, which he says is very precious in God's sight. Okay, so now he's not forbidding women from ever, you know, wearing braids or having a nice hairdo or from wearing jewelry. That's not what he's saying. But he's saying he's prohibiting women from spending an excessive amount of time, money, or energy on their outward appearance and from wearing clothing that would be immodest. That's the emphasis. All right. Okay, so he gives some instruction to wives. And then in verse 7 of chapter 3, now he's going to shift his attention to another group of Christians. He's going to talk to husbands. Okay, and what does he tell husbands? He says he instructs husbands to live with their wives in an understanding way. So what does that mean, to live in an understanding way? Does that mean you're just, you know, you're understanding and you're considerate? Well, I think it means that, but I think it means more than that. Because literally, if you have a King James, this verse says, husbands are to live with their wives according to knowledge. According to knowledge. Okay, so what kind of knowledge is he referring to? Well, I think he means at least two forms of knowledge. One is the objective knowledge of God's will for all husbands, as we're instructed in other parts of the Bible. So, for example, Ephesians 5:25 tells husbands to love your wives even as Christ also loved the church and gave himself for it. Okay, so we are to have a self-sacrificial love for our wives. But there's also, a subjective knowledge that husbands should have of their individual wives, right? We should know the unique personality and strengths and weaknesses and physical and emotional and spiritual makeup of the wife whom God has given you, all right? And so why is this important to husbands? Well, he tells us at the end of the verse, right? He says, we should do this, live with our wives in an understanding way, showing honor to the woman as the weaker vessel, since they are heirs with you of the grace of life, so that, in order that, your prayers may not be hindered. Okay? So there's an important reason why husbands should, we should live this way. Now, there's I read a commentator, I've forgotten who this was, but he said something I thought was very helpful on this point. He said this, he says, no Christian husband should presume to think that any spiritual good will be accomplished by his life without an effective ministry of prayer. And no husband may expect an effective prayer life unless he lives with his wife in an understanding way, bestowing honor on her. To take the time to develop and maintain a good marriage is God's will. It is serving God. It is a spiritual activity pleasing in his sight. Okay? So this is an important instruction for husbands. Then verses 8 through 12, Peter goes back now to kind of giving some general instructions to all believers. You know, he had talked to wives, servants, and then wives and husbands. Now he's saying, all of you, he says, have a unity of mind, sympathy, brotherly love, a tender heart, and a humble mind. And that word in verse 8, have a unity of mind, it means harmonious or of one mind. And so in many other places in the New Testament, we are exhorted to believers are exhorted to live together in harmony or have one mind, be of one mind. And, you know, why would that be? Why are there so many admonitions in the New Testament? Peter gives us one here, to live in harmony and have unity of mind. Well, the reality is that sadly, because a lot of times, you know, churches are prone to experiencing the opposite, that division and dissension, right? And so if we want to avoid that, we need to pursue not only unity of mind, but these other attributes that he identifies there in verse 8, right? Sympathy, brotherly love, tender heart, and humility, a humble mind. Okay, so that's 8. Now, and then verses 13 through 15. So this is where we left off a couple years ago, 3 years ago. So that was a real quick summary, all right? So we had to go at warp speed. So if you're interested in anything more of that, you could do a little studying of your own or listen to those sermons if you want. Okay, so verses 13 through 15, Peter begins a new section of his letter with these verses, 13 through 15 of chapter 3. From chapter 2, verse 13, to chapter 3, verse 12, he addressed the godly behavior that was required by different groups of Christians in various stations of life. So we just looked at that. Now, beginning in 3:13 and continuing through 4:11, he focuses more directly on the call for all Christians to suffer in a God-honoring way. That's what he's going to emphasize now. So he says in verse 14, he says, but even if you should suffer for righteousness' sake, you will be blessed. And that's similar to what Jesus said on the Sermon on the Mount. Do you remember that? Matthew 5:10, he said, blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Okay? But it's important to note that both Jesus and Peter, they qualify this blessing that we will receive when we suffer. It's on believers being persecuted or on suffering for righteousness' sake. So what does that mean? Well, what does it not mean? Well, it does not mean that, you know, you suffer because maybe you're obnoxious, or you're objectionable, or you're difficult to get along with, or because of sin in your life, right? Sometimes Christians are persecuted because their zeal outweighs their common courtesy or their common sense, right? And they become obnoxious to the people they're trying to witness to. And so Jesus and Peter, they're not saying, blessed are those who are suffering as Christians because they are seriously lacking in wisdom and are really foolish and unwise in what they consider to be a good testimony, all right? So the promise of blessing isn't for people who act like that. But the promise, so we want to be careful, but the promise is for those who are being persecuted for righteousness' sake, for following Christ and living a righteous life. And then in verse 15, he says, gives us some instruction when we're witnessing to others. He says, but in your hearts, honor Christ the Lord as holy, always being prepared to make a defense to anyone who asks you for a reason for the hope that is in you, yet do it with gentleness and respect. All right, and that word, you may know this, that's translated defense, always being prepared to make a defense. That's the word apologia. We get our, it means a verbal defense or a reasoned statement or argument. We get our word apologetics from that word. So when we encounter hostile unbelievers and we're challenged concerning our faith, you can be tempted to respond how? Harshly, right? You know, sometimes making a defense of the faith can easily turn into attacking our opponents. But because of this, Peter, he adds this last phrase to verse 15. He says, yet do it. Be prepared to give a defense, to give a rational argument for your faith, why you believe, for the hope that's in you, but do it with gentleness and respect. And that word gentleness could also be translated meekness. And that's the word that Zeke was talking about a couple weeks ago, and he was talking about 1 Corinthians 13, so one of the attributes of love, this meekness, right? Not asserting yourself, your own rights, right? Submitting. And so we are to do this with gentleness, meekness, and respect. And here's a commentator that by the name of William Barclay had a very good, I thought, a very helpful quote on this idea of doing this with meekness. He says, there are many people who state their beliefs with a kind of arrogant belligerence. Their attitude is that anyone who does not agree with them is either a fool or a knave, and they seek to ram their beliefs down other people's throats. The case for Christianity must be presented with winsomeness and with love, and with that wise tolerance which realizes that it is not given to any man to possess the whole truth. Men may be wooed into the Christian faith when they cannot be bullied into it. All right? So I thought that was helpful to this idea of having gentleness and respect, meekness, as we answer those and as we give a reason for the hope that lies within us. All right. Well, that's where we left off there at the end of 15. And so I know that's a very quick and kind of a cursory review of these chapters. But I hope that by way of summary, this might have stirred you up by way of reminder to some of these truths. And we'll pick up again here, Lord willing, next time we'll pick up in verses 16 through 19 of chapter 3. So let's pray. Our Father in heaven, Lord, we thank you for your word. We thank you for this epistle of the Apostle Peter. Lord, thank you for what it teaches us, instructs us. And Father, I pray that you'd help us to apply these truths, to live them out, Lord. Help us to endure suffering well, to suffer for righteousness' sake. Father, help us to submit to the authorities that are over us. Help us to maintain a good testimony as we engage with non-believers. Lord, help husbands and wives to fulfill their roles in marriage. Lord, we pray that you would just work in our hearts and our lives. Lord, we thank you that you use the imperishable seed of your word to cause men and women and boys and girls to be born again to a living hope. And we pray, Father, that you would do this. You would be gracious. Lord, we pray for those who are unconverted in our midst, our children, unconverted spouses, that you would come and use your word and apply it to hearts and cause your seed to bear fruit. Lord, we pray that you would save men and women in our midst. So we look to you and we ask and pray all of these things in Jesus' name. Amen.